When you walk in the God kind of faith, you have the final say. The Christian has the final say. I know you've been singing that song. Who has the final say? Jehovah has the final say. Can I shock you here? Jehovah does not have the final say. Why? Because the Christian is not operating under the name of Jehovah. The Christian is operating under the name of Jesus. That name has the final say. Ephesians chapter 3 says, I bow my knees unto the Father, of whom the whole family in heaven and on earth is named. That name is the name of Jesus. What does it say? It says that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things and beings in heaven, of things and beings on this earth, and of things and beings under the earth. Jesus. When we get born again, we are baptized into that name.
Pastor Prince, word here.
Our priestly ministry in prayer.
I've taught a lot of things about prayer, praying in the Holy Spirit, benefits of praying in the Holy Spirit, spiritual sensitivity and all that. Today I'm talking about the priestly ministry of the Christian in prayer. The Christian has a priestly ministry in prayer. Acts chapter 10 verse 1. Are we all there? I want us to read it. Acts chapter 10 verse 1 to 3, I think. It's very important. I'm sharing, it's very important to me. Acts chapter 10 verse 1 to 4. Shall we all read it together? 1, 2, go.
There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Brotherhood, and a devout man, and a man that feared God with all of his house, who believed in much alms to the people, and prayed to God always.
He prayed to God how?
Always.
He prayed to God how?
Always.
Always. Verse 3. 1, 2, go.
He saw in a vision evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming against him, and standing unto him, Cornelius. And when he went looking from him, he was afraid, and he said, What is it, Lord? And he said unto him, Thy prayers and thy alms are come up for the memorial for God.
Stop. Shall we all take verse 4 again? 1, 2, go.
And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, What is this, Lord? And he said unto him, Thy prayers and thy alms are come up from the memorial for God.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He talks about a man called Cornelius. The scripture says that he feared God. He feared God. And he prayed always. Now, this man was not born again. Listen very carefully. The significance of our prayer life. How important our prayer life is. He says that Cornelius was a man who feared God and prayed always, and he gave alms. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him whilst he was praying. They are Christians who have never seen angels before. Yet a person that was not born again saw angels. Why? Because he was giving and he was praying. Not born again. So that God was so much interested in such a man to the point where he had to go and call one of the apostles to go and preach to him to be saved. He was not saved. But God wanted him and his house to be saved because he feared God, the Bible says, and he was a Gentile. He gave alms. But what is very, very important is that the scripture says that his prayer and his alms became a memorial before God. So you see, there is a time where we pray for God to hear. And we pray for answers. Then there's another spiritual understanding concerning prayer when we pray and our prayers become a memorial. Look at what I just said. So he says that his prayer became a memorial before God. Now the word memorial means record. A reminder. So it means that in the sight of God and in the mind of God, whose ears is open to our prayers. The man had prayed so much to that point because he was praying always. Say always.
Always.
When Daniel was praying three times, it was recorded in the Bible. This one, he did not say he was praying three times. You see, he said he was praying always. And his prayer and his arms had become a memorial before God. It was set before God like this. When we pray in the New Testament, our prayer becomes a memorial. Write it down. It's very important. I'll show you how. When we pray in the New Testament, our prayer becomes a memorial. When we pray in the New Testament, our prayer becomes a memorial. See, what we all know about prayer is for praying for some needs to be met and all that. But when we pray, our prayer becomes a memorial. Imagine your prayers becoming a memorial in the sight of God. Did you catch what I just said? So he had prayed, you see, we don't only, and I want you to catch this understanding. We don't only pray because we have troubles. Because that is what many Christians have been taught. And many Christians pray because when they enter the church, this is how they all pray and they join to pray. You see? But we have come to change things. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Because we don't only pray because we have a need. We don't only pray because we have troubles. We don't pray when we feel like praying or we don't feel like praying. Today I felt like it. Today I don't feel like, because prayer is a spiritual thing. It's not physical. So you don't have to feel like it before. It's spiritual. In spirituality, we make things happen. We don't wait for things to just be there. So when I feel like praying, I feel, no, we make prayer happen. In spirituality, in Christianity, we make prayer happen. It means that we don't pray when we feel like praying. Today I felt like praying. No, we pray. Say, I pray.
I pray.
Oh, say, I pray.
I pray.
You see, so he says that this man prayed and his prayer became a memorial. Now, Jesus gave a parable in Luke chapter 18. Can we go there? Luke chapter 18. Kadabasata dabaha. Luke chapter 18 verse 1. Reading downwards. Who is there? So men ought always to pray and not to faint. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In the New Testament, prayer is a ministry. Write it down. Prayer is a ministry. Prayer is a ministry. And it is a priestly ministry of the Christian, not the man of God, not the prophet, but the Christian. So any prophet who says, bring me money and I'll be praying for you, or bring me so and so and I'll fast and pray for you. And some people do that. They say, we'll fast and pray for you. Then you go and sleep in your room. You are waiting and the man of God is fasting and praying for you. The man of God has a responsibility to pray for his people. Amen. But it does not mean that the Christian does not have a ministry of prayer. You hear what I just said? So we have, and it is called the priestly ministry of the Christian. Amen. In the New Testament, we have been made priests and kings. Now go to Psalm 141 before I enter into the New Testament very well. Psalm 141 verse 2. Lete prahaya. Let my prayer be set forth before thee as incense, and the lifting up of my hands as what? The evening sacrifices. This was David speaking. Says, let my prayer be set before you as incense. What was he saying? He was saying that he wanted his prayer to be set as a memorial before God, as incense. You see? Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, why did he say that? Let my prayer be set forth before thee as incense, And the lifting up of my hands. So when we say lift up your hands, we are not telling you to do exercise. It's a spiritual practice, which an Old Testament saint knew. Which an Old Testament saint. So the one in the New Testament, born of God, who cannot lift up his hands during prayer, is in trouble. There is a significant role that every practice in prayer plays. When we lift up our hands, for instance, it's a form of reverence and surrender in prayer. So when we say lift up your hands, when it's the time to pray, we say lift up your hands. You don't do like this and do like this and do like this and do like this. No. Very important. Whatever I'm sharing with you today is very important. Don't take it lightly. But it says, let my prayer be set before you as incense. So in the mind of David, his prayer was going before the Lord as incense. Why did he say that? Because David was a king. Anointed as a king. Anointed as a prophet. And anointed as a priest. David had three important offices that he was anointed into in the Old Testament. So here, he was not speaking as a prophet, he was speaking as a priest. And not as a king. So he knew that prayer was like incense. And you see, in the Old Testament, what happened was that God instructed Moses to build a tabernacle. Listen very carefully. And whilst Moses was building the tabernacle, the tabernacle was just a shadow of the heavenly tabernacle that was in heaven. And we are in that tabernacle now. Amen. Amen. We actually live in the Holy of Holies. We live there. Shout hallelujah. You see, but Moses was instructed to build a pattern of that which was in heaven. But I wouldn't go into all of that because it's not very relevant for now. But I want to show you something that was there. So in building the tabernacle, God instructed, showed him how he should do it. So that the earthly tabernacle will look like the heavenly one. And so that God's presence will dwell in that tabernacle. Because at that time, God was dealing with the Jews, the Israelites, and they were not born again. So he was dealing with natural men. In building the tabernacle, he told Moses to build what we call the altar of incense. Say the altar of incense.
The altar of incense.
And the altar of incense was built in the tabernacle. You can see that in Exodus chapter 30, verse 1, reading downwards. Was built because he wanted the priest. You see, the priest in the Old Testament to offer incense every morning and every evening. So what the priest was doing was that they were offering incense on the altar every morning, every evening. And that was a shadow of something to come. That was a figure, a shadow. So the priest will always offer incense in the morning. Then the priest will offer incense in the evening. Why? Go to Luke chapter 1. Verse 9 to 12. Luke chapter 1. Verse 9 to 12. Shall we all read together? 1, 2, go. According to what?
The custom of the priest office.
Of the priest office. Uh-huh.
His lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord.
Uh-huh. His lot. That's one of his roles. So the priest in the Old Testament, we had priests. You see. And the priest was to burn incense. And you see, Zachariah was a priest. The father of John the Baptist. Shout it out loud. Uh-huh.
And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the sign of.
And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside. The word without them means outside, like in King James English. They were praying outside. So in newer translation, you said they were praying outside. And the priest was supposed to do what? Burn incense as a responsibility, as a duty. Not when he chose to or not. I want you to catch it here. So it was the duty of the priest to burn incense as, that was his responsibility. You see, when you study the scriptures carefully, you discover that our givings in the house of God is a priestly ministry. Our givings. The priest was supposed to burn incense in the Old Testament. The priest was supposed to offer sacrifices, to give offerings. So we have burnt offerings, and that's why I say that if people say that we should go and the whole Bible was written by God, so go and live in the Old Testament, both, and then they should begin to burn offerings, do burnt offerings and all that. You slay a goat and burn it, and you slay this and burn it, and nobody can say that is idolatry. Amen. The priest had a responsibility of offering sacrifices, givings. So our giving, even in the house of God, you see, is a priestly duty. Our prayer life now is a priestly duty.
Pastor Prince will be right back.
When money comes into your hands now, you don't know where the money is. I see them attacking your money, your finances. So when you hold money, it's as if there is this demon. It's as if the demon is snatching the thing from you. Have you ever had a dream like that? You had a dream like that?
Yes.
You had a dream like that? If you get a good job, any good job you get, there will be an issue. They don't want to even see your face. Is that true?
Yes.
Is it true? I'm telling you the truth.
Come out!
We are here to change your life. At World Changers, we make things happen. Anytime you try to apply, they are always refused. Can you come so I pray for you?
Testimonies are the manifestations of our inheritance in Christ. The Bible says in Psalm 96 verse 3 that, publish his glorious deeds among the nations, tell everyone about the amazing things he does.
People like us, me, who ride bicycle and come here, sometimes in the night, in the afternoon, you'll be on bicycle and everybody's driving and passing, you are riding and going. You go to some time, I said, why I do what I do?
It's a big testimony. I'm so happy, and it's a life-changing thing. When they showed me the house I'm going to live in, I said, I spoke in tongues.
Life has not been easy for myself and then my siblings. Sometimes we don't have any food at home, and we don't have any money, even sometimes transportation to go to church. Yeah, it was so bad. Now everything, it's okay with my family, and I just bless God for Papa's life and for this ministry.
Join us for our special teachings and prophetic service every last Sunday of the month, 9:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. at the Airport West Hotel, Accra. You can download other messages of Pastor Prince online by logging on to www.ministerprinceonline.org. You are blessed.
You are watching Pastor Prince teaching.
So in the Old Testament, Zachariah was doing what? Was burning incense, and the people were outside praying and was burning incense. And he was going to burn incense morning and evening. Then the scripture says that whilst he was burning the incense, an angel of the Lord appeared on the altar of incense. Read it. 1, 2, go. Verse 11. 1, 2, go.
And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zachariah saw him, he was troubled.
At the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zachariah saw him, what happened?
He was troubled.
And fear fell upon him.
And the angel said unto the angel servant, Zachariah,
and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John, and thou shalt have joy in gladness.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Whilst they were outside there praying, and he was burning incense. Why was he burning incense? Because God was dealing with natural men. So the only way they could know that their prayers were going was through the incense. So when they saw the incense going, they could say, our prayer is going. They were natural men. You see how it is? So, when they saw their prayers, they said, oh, now our prayer is going. So, David, the priest, was speaking with this kind of understanding. And I've given an illustration, an example from Zacharias' own. When the angel came and the incense was going, then David says, let my prayer be set forth as what? As incense before thee. And then it says, the lifting up of my hands as evening sacrifice. So there was an evening sacrifice that the priest was supposed to perform every night, every evening, apart from the burning of incense. It's called the evening sacrifice. And he was supposed to sacrifice lamps every evening. You understand? Every evening. So the lifting up of his hands was what? Significant of that. The evening sacrifice was a type of lifting up your hands. That is why Paul told Timothy, he says what? Lifting up what? Holy hands. That was what Paul was telling Timothy. So lifting up your hands in prayer is very important. When we say lift up your hands, and your hands is just like lift up your hands, you'll be missing things. So the man of God did not prophesy. Pass me by. Your hands were down. Your hands. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, I've showed you about the Old Testament. So, when they saw the incense going, they could say that their prayers was going to go. They were natural men. They had to see physically to believe. So if you tell them, your sins are forgiven, they had to see physically. They couldn't believe. How can you just say my sins are forgiven? You understand? So all of those things was important. But now in the New Testament, the scripture says, Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. Oh, talabason tolobositata. It's a very short message, but with very important details that you don't have to miss. So when people ask, why do we always have to pray? You don't say, because man always has troubles. Oh, it's very important. You are always praying. You're always praying. Say, because we are all full of troubles. No. My peace I give you. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Revelation chapter what? Verse. What is he saying there? Start from verse 5 and this is what it says there. 1, 2, go.
And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the dead and rotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, from him that loved us, God washed us from our sins in his own blood.
Oh, powerful.
And
has made us kings and priests unto God. So in the New Testament, you don't have to occupy the office of the priest like in the old. In the New Testament, when you are born again, you are born into the office of priesthood. You hear what I just said? So every Christian is a priest. And you see, this is different from the offices or the ministerial offices. I met someone some years ago. Are you following what I'm saying? And there were some people and they were arguing as to whether a person should be a pastor or a prophet or not. And they said nobody should be a pastor or a prophet because we are all pastors. Why? Because we are all priests. And they were arguing. At that time I had gone to a mountain and they were arguing. I was looking at them as ignorant. Ministerial offices, fivefold offices are there. But you see, when we are born again, we are made priests. He says, he has made us, not he will make us. He has made us unto Jesus Christ, the faithful judge and all that, the prince of the kings and all that. He says that he has made us kings and priests, or priests and kings. Now, if he has made us priests, then he expects us to offer incense as priests. Did you catch that? The same scripture, you see, when you see emphasis, go to Revelation chapter 5 verse 10. You see the same thing there. Say, I am a priest in Christ Jesus.
I am a priest in Christ Jesus.
Oh. Say, I am a priest in Christ Jesus.
I am a priest in Christ Jesus.
Say, I am a king in Christ Jesus.
I am a king in Christ Jesus.
Revelation chapter 5 verse 10. What does it say there?
And has made us
unto our God, what?
Kings and priests.
So Jesus has made us unto our God. So in the sight of God, we are not only the child of God, we are also priests. In the mind of God, we are not only priests, we are kings. Jesus made us like that. So Jesus is the high priest. We are the priests. And we perform priestly duties. And one of the priestly duties we perform is to pray. It means something. It means that when we pray, we are offering up incense to God. When we pray, we are offering up spiritual incense to God as a memorial, so that our prayer releases incense from our altar. Where is the altar? Your spirit. So the incense ascends to the Father. The more we pray, the more our incense is seen by the Father. It's not a physical incense.
Thank you for watching. Join Pastor Prince next week on Changing Your World. You are blessed.
Hello. Welcome to Changing Your World with Pastor Prince. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It's a blessing to come your way this time. You see, the scripture says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, it is who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. It says God wants all men, not some men. All men, including you that are not born. You are not born again. I'm speaking to you. He wants all men to be saved. Why? Because until you are saved, you are still under the dominion of darkness. You are still under the dominion of the devil. You have still made the devil the Lord of your life. You are identified with him and his nature of sin. You cannot stop sinning unless you are born again. That's what Jesus said. You must be born again. So God wants all men to be saved. When you are saved, you are identified with the Lordship of Jesus. When you are saved, you are planted, placed in the kingdom of his dear Son. You are placed in Christ Jesus. So if you are not yet born again, this is an opportunity for you to be born again. And if you are not yet born again, confess this after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe you were raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. I confess you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for coming into my heart. Amen. And if you are saved, you need knowledge. You need knowledge. But I pray for you. I pray in the name of Jesus that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened, that you'll be flooded with light, that the spirit of wisdom and revelation will be operational in and through you, in the name of Jesus, that you may come to the knowledge of the truth, in the mighty name of Jesus. I release the blessings of the Spirit on your life. I command healings to take place right now. Every sickness, spirits of infirmities, spirits of cancer, spirits of tumor, tuberculosis, come out in the name of Jesus. I release healing. I minister healing into your body. I minister healing into your bones in the mighty name of Jesus. I release miracles on your path. Miracles in the name of Jesus. I release your testimony in the name of Jesus. You are blessed. Glorious things are spoken of you. Till we come your way next time, remain blessed. Amen.